بسم الله، اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. اللهم صل وسلم وأنعم وأكرم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه في الأولين وفي الآخرين وفي الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow this time, these few minutes that we spend together every night, supplicating and learning one of the prophetic dua. May this time be a time of increase and a time of guidance and a time of healing and a time of acceptance. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with all of us in this blessed and sacred month of Ramadan. May He grant us the highest of heights, and may He grant us the ultimate goal of salvation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us and make us amongst those who are saved from Jahannam. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam notes that in every single night of the nights of Ramadan, there are utaqa, there are those who will attain salvation. There are those who will be saved from Jahannam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this blessed night of Ramadan to make us amongst the utaqa, those who are saved. Allahumma ameen ya rabbil alameen. Inshallah, the dua that we are going to reflect on this evening is a dua that Anas ibn Malik, and Anas ibn Malik was the khadim, he was the helper and the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he said, I would serve the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam every single day as he would leave. And I used to always hear him when he leaves the house or leaves his abode, he would say this dua. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazan wa a'udhu bika min al-ajzi wal-kasal wa a'udhu bika min al-jubni wal-bukhl wa a'udhu bika min ghalabati al-dayni wa qahri al-rijal. This is the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would make every morning and every evening. And this dua is, O Allah, I seek refuge in you from sorrow and grief, from incapacity and laziness, from cowardice and miserliness, and I seek protection in you from overwhelming debt and the tyranny of men. Now, why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam make this dua? Why these particular categories? And what we will come to note is that in each of these categories, the first two being al-hamm wal-hazan, to be someone who is has sorrow or grief, mahmum, concerned, overly concerned, or having some form of grief or anxiety. That's an internal reality. And then you have incapacity and laziness, and that's something that afflicts the physical body. So someone can be handicapped, or someone may just not want to get up or move. So you have something that may afflict us internally, something that may afflict our bodies, something that may afflict us in the space of action and movement and productivity. So na'udhu bika min al-bukhli wal-jubn, or min al-jubni wal-bukhl. These are in contradistinction to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be, which is to be brave people and competent people and people who are productive and in motion, people who are giving. And then the last category is from ghalabatu ad-dayni wa qahri ar-rijal, and the overwhelming nature of debt, right, that can be very burdensome and can devour us and can make us feel completely suffocated. And then also the tyranny of man, right? Individuals, people in our life, people that can be in our close inner circles and people from outside, but that can really be a source of extreme burden. So you notice that these are four categories. Each of them have two ailments, if you will, embedded within them. And this was the Prophet ﷺ seeking a holistic form of relief and protection. Because if I am inhibited from within, meaning that I have anxiety, I have burdensome worry, right? I am constantly fearful. Then that can be a very debilitating internal orientation if I have that within me. So the Prophet ﷺ, he would seek refuge in anything that would debilitate him internally, as well as anything physiologically in the body, an inability of one of the limbs, or just that general state of not wanting to move, feeling a certain way, you know. And we've all experienced that laziness. Sometimes we wake up with laziness, sometimes in the midday we get lazy, and sometimes in the evening we get lazy. And so there is, if I am lazy, then I become inhibited, and productivity lessens, and my willingness and my desire to pray, to fast, to go visit someone, to go help someone move, to do my chores and my responsibilities, you know, to go out for a walk, to do productive things becomes clearly in question because I'm lazy or I'm tired or whatever the case is. Then there are certainly, you know, those particular ailments that can paralyze so much good in society. When you see, for example, that there is no doubt economic strife and difficulty, and people in large swaths of people have economic needs, and I covet what I have, and so I become miserly, and you know I'm worried about my own well-being, and so I look at my bank account and it has a nice little chunk of money, and I'm like, you know, I'm going to keep that just for me, and you kind of turn a blind eye to others' needs. And if everyone in society is kind of looking at inwardly in that fashion, meaning that they're looking towards their own self-preservation, then what happens to others, right? And so that affliction of miserliness, it can be debilitating to social welfare. And also miserliness is deeply problematic from a spiritual perspective, because miserliness is synonymous with doubting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That I doubt that Allah will give me, or that I doubt that Allah will give me more, or that I doubt He's al-Razzaq, because miserliness is saying that, oh, I have this small, these few little pennies, these few little nuts, like I can't let them go, because if I do, then I'm going to be at a loss. Well, who gave you that? Who gave us that in the first place? Right? So, you know, and then jubn, we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from being jubana, from being people who are fearful, overly fearful, in a blameworthy fashion. And certainly so many people become harmed in society. And so much virtue is lost in society because of a lack of willingness or a desire to speak the truth. You know, the Prophet ﷺ says, say the truth, قُلِ الْحَقِّ وَلَوْ كَانَ مُرَّ. Say the truth even if it's bitter. Even if the reaction that we may get from speaking the truth is going to bring about some sort of hardship or difficulty. And so, you know, jubn is truly a tremendous problem when it becomes prevalent among societies. Everyone just kind of wanting to stay to themselves, no one wanting to say anything. And certainly one quality that the Prophet ﷺ was not, he was not a coward. He was not someone afraid to say the truth and to speak and to be forthcoming. Now, of course, we have to be wise and we have to use the best of words and we have to be, you know, sensible in our speech and our approach. But that doesn't mean that we should ever fear or shy away from, you know, articulating and speaking the truth and really, you know, advocating for virtue and morality, right? And having the inner power to even come against someone who is in my family, you know, who may be committing wrong. You know, if I know of someone who's an abuser in the home, someone who beats their spouse or their child, in an abusive fashion. The Prophet ﷺ says, you know, bring victory to your brother, whether they are oppressed or an oppressor. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, we know how to bring them victory as oppressed, but how do we do that as them if they are oppressors? He said, hold their hands, meaning that you have to stop them. And so there are people in our homes today that, you know, suffer in silence. And there are at times people in the community, friends, family members, at times others who know, but they stay quiet. And they stay quiet almost in a form of cowardice. They don't want to, you know, that person's a strong person. That person can do something to me. So just, you know, let them continue to do what they're doing and I'm just going to turn a blind eye. And you see what kind of pain and suffering that person is in. That woman who's in an abusive relationship, who's really crying out for help. And there are a bunch of, you know, men and women in the community who are not there to help her. You know, and because of some, you know, communal consideration or cultural consideration. So we have to seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from being jubana, from being cowardly people or being fearful, right? And lastly, certainly, you know, as a clear extension of this are the forces around us that may completely suffocate us and overwhelm us, you know, the tyranny of men, the tyranny of people. Aggressive, you know, a tyrant in the home, a tyrant governing a country, you know, harmful people in a community, harmful people in a neighborhood. All of that can be such a debilitating experience and it can completely freeze a person and terrorize a person. And that's something that we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from ever having in our orbit. And also not having economic concerns like debt that would, you know, be the concern of ours in every waking moment. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lift debts from upon those who are suffering from much debt that can truly be a debilitating aspect in their life. So these are four categories that the Prophet ﷺ is seeking refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from having or being afflicted with, and that this way, when Allah protects us from all four of these categories, then we're free and we're light-footed and we're able to worship and we're able to thrive and be productive and engage in meaningful acts and fulfill, most importantly, our divine responsibility and duty, and that is to call to the way of Allah and His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So inshallah, with that, we will make the dua together. In a spirit of khudu'a, in a spirit of surrender, and in a spirit of humility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazan. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-ajzi wal-kasal. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-jubni wal-bukhl. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ghalabati al-dayni wa qahri al-rijal. Allahumma ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with these beautiful meanings and virtues in the blessed and sacred month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us and guide us and help us to be righteous servants who are always in loving surrender to their Creator. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautify our hearts and beautify our homes and beautify our spaces with La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullah khair, and inshallah we'll be together tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.